Okay, guys, welcome back to FRM 120. We are quickly approaching the end of our electrical section of this class. We have talked about the three phase, and up to this point, the three phase is controlled motors. It's also controlled the current flow to heating elements as well. Today's lesson is on variable frequency drives, and it pertains strictly to motors, okay? Three phase motors in particular. All right, we know how those work. This is a different way of controlling them, okay? They come in all shapes and sizes. These are made by Allen Bradley. This one was made by ABB. Regardless of the manufacturer, they all do the same thing and they do it the same way. The biggest difference is the size of them, what size of motor it's going to control, and also the features. Some of them will have communications capabilities on there, hook them up through PLCs and computers and control them through Ethernet. Some are just very, very basic, like the one I've got right here. This is one that's very inexpensive from Automation Direct. It's a couple hundred bucks, and you can ramp the speed up and down with a little keypad with the arrows. You can turn the knob and dial the variation of the output to it, to the motor, turn on and off, and you know, there's no communication or anything on this particular drive, so we have to control it with start and stop push buttons or the keypad itself. But my point is that they come in all shapes and sizes, and you know, different costs as well, and obviously the more features, the more expensive it is. But we also call them freak drives, okay? And if you've got a very large variable frequency drive, we call them she's a super freak, she's super freaky. Not really, but I just thought I'd show you. Pay close attention because this guy's going to be on the quiz, all right? Yeah, this guy. That's what you figure out. So anyway, this is a pump cart that has a variable frequency drive on the cart. The motor itself, it's hooked to the motor, and we vary the speed of the motor, which then varies the speed of the pump, and that varies the flow of the pump coming of the liquid coming out of the pump. So you've probably seen some of these if you've done some practicum hours in some of the breweries that have these, okay? This is a picture of a DC motor. This is a direct current motor, okay? Very large and very complex in as far as its makeup. Back in the day, this was the only way that you could control the speed of a motor is if you had a DC motor, okay? They were really large as far as physical. They had a lot more components in them as well. This motor has carbon brushes that conduct the electricity between the rotor and the field, the stator windings. The carbon brushes would wear. This right here is a commutator. The commutator would glaze over and often have to be resurfaced so that the bright shiny copper would come out and make good contact with the carbon brushes. My point is that there was a lot of arcing and things, a lot of maintenance involved in the DC motor, but at that time, it was the only way to control the speed of a motor. AC motors were strictly one speed, okay? Full speed, and that was it. And it had a lot more complex components that were used to control the speed or vary the speed of the DC motor. So that, like I said, that was all back in the day. Along comes the 1980s, along with this, and the advent of the VFD is upon us in the 1980s. This gave us controlled acceleration, okay? That's our ramp up speed. We could go from zero to full speed over the course of, take 10, 15, 20, 30, 60 seconds, however long we wanted to ramp that speed from zero to our full speed. It also gave us controlled deceleration, going from full speed all the way down to zero. And instead of just doing a flat shutoff or a hard stop, we could slowly control the deceleration. We had different braking methods. In other words, when we shut that motor off, did we let it kind of freewheel, or did we apply a braking force that's part of the VFD? The VFD can add a brake, not a mechanical physical brake, but an electrical brake that we'll talk about here shortly. And it gave excellent efficiency, improved efficiency, and cost savings as well. One of the things, the way it did this is a lot of times large motors will always spike when they start up. And the utility company will measure your billing off of these spikes, the frequency, how much, things like that. That's what they use to charge a facility for its power bill. So if you can bring that spike down and slowly bring the motor up, you don't get that big inrush current spike, and so therefore it keeps it under the radar with the power company. So that's one of the ways that it does that, okay? The features of some of the drives, it gives us diagnostics for the drive itself. It'll tell you if something's wrong with the drive. It'll also tell you if you've got a problem with the motor as well. It can be controlled by the operator. In other words, I can use the push buttons on the front pad here on the keypad, or I can use a PLC, which is a programmable logic controller. It's basically an industrial computer that controls, you know, a lot of the automation in factories and things like that, but it can be controlled by a computer. And we use them primarily in brewing operations for the transfer of the water from the HLT and to the mash tun, from the mash tun to the boil kettle, from the boil kettle to the fermenter. Okay? We also use it for cleaning. We run our sandy, we run our flushes through there with our sandy and our acid, and we use our variable speeds to clean with as well. One thing I will tell you is when we transfer, it's part of getting your process in control. You want it in tight control so that when you are brewing a beer that you don't have a lot of variations. One time you'll transfer a full bore, and the next time you're squeezing it off, you know, tighten it off and just allowing a limited amount of flow. What you're looking for in the brewing process is tight control so that you get a quality product every time. Most of you know by now that if you try to transfer too quickly out of your mash tun into the boil kettle, you can collapse the grain bed. You wind up picking up a lot of extra particulates, dumping it in the boil kettle. So if you can dial in on a flow rate that is consistent and works for you every time, you can set that drive, the variable frequency drive, to a certain frequency that allows the flow to vessel from vessel to vessel each and every time. These kinds of things like this, whirlpooling speeds, other things like that, transferring to the fermenter, these are the types of things that you want to really keep in control and do it right and do it every time at the same frequency regardless, as long as it works, okay? But that's one of the things that the variable frequency drive can do for you, okay? Now, we looked at this schematic, you know, when we were doing motor controls, okay? Well, this is the variable frequency drive will take the place of a lot of things in this particular drawing. For example, we don't use a motor starter, and we don't use that sealing circuit around our start button. We don't have to use that because it's all incorporated in the variable frequency drive. We don't have to have a control transformer that steps it down, say, from 480 or 208 or whatever, down to a lower control voltage. We don't have to have the transformer because we do our control in here. So basically, and if we chose to, if we selected it in one of the parameters in the drive, we could do away with the stop and start button altogether and just do everything there in the drive. That can be very convenient, but it can also be inconvenient. If you have a workstation where all your control buttons are, you don't want to have to reach down and press a drive button. You want to just hit a start button, it sends a signal to the drive and does it for you. So that's why these are not X'd out, because on that pump cart, you'll see a start and stop button. But sometimes they'll be remote, just depends on how big the brewery actually is. But it does away with a lot of those other components. Those are components that can go bad and just create more problems for you. So we put them all in the drive, and things have worked very well for that since we brought the VFD on the scene. Now, there's a couple of ways that you can control the speed of an AC motor, of an alternating current motor. And one of the ways is to if you went from a four-pole motor to a two-pole motor, or from a four-pole motor to a six-pole motor, that's completely impractical. You'd have to take the motor apart, rewind it, put it all back just to change speeds. Very, very impractical, very, very expensive, okay? So that's not a good way to do that. So changing the poles is not so. However, you can change the frequency at which the motor sees the voltage, okay? And so, but now, wait a minute. We said that the power company delivers our power at 60 hertz per second. In other words, our sine wave, we have 60 cycles of the sine waves within 1 second. That's the 60 hertz. But we can't vary that, but we can. Okay, we can't vary the incoming frequency, but we can we can control the outgoing frequency to the motor. But I want to show you real quick a formula here, how this works. Now, synchronous speed is the speed at which that rotating magnetic field is going around and around, okay? That synchronous speed is opposed to actual speed of the motor. There's a slight difference. It's called slip. We're not going into this. I just want to talk about synchronous speed just to keep things simple and move things along. So the 120 here, the 120 the 120 is a fixed number, okay? That stays in our formula, that stays, okay? The 60 hertz is going to stay consistent with our, typically from our power company, okay? And then the number of poles, that's not, like I said earlier, it's not practical to change those. So this is the formula, though. You take the given, the fixed number 120, multiply it by your frequency and divide it by the number of poles in your motor. And most motors in the U.S. are four-pole. They run about 1,800 RPMs, okay? So the difference there is we're going to change the frequency of our formula, and we can change that with the variable frequency drive. Varying the frequency is what we're going to do. So that if we vary the frequency, we're going to vary the shaft speed of our motor, okay? Now, let's change things up a little bit, all right? Let's suppose now the fixed number is 120, and we still are running a four-pole motor, okay, induction motor, and our drive now gives us 30 hertz. When you do the math, 120 times 30, and you divide it by that four poles in the motor, we're now running at 900 RPMs on the motor shaft because we have changed the frequency going to the motor. And again, it's not practical to do that. We can't do that from the power plant, so we have to do it with the drive, okay? And that's what we're doing right here. Now, this is kind of the inner workings of a variable frequency drive. And it's really, I think this is really cool. Probably one of the neatest, not say inventions, but the neatest advances in technology to come along in a while. But here you've got your three-phase voltage going in. Okay, you got three-phase voltage going right here. And these little triangles with the lines across them, these are known as diodes. And these diodes do something for us. So we've got these alternating sine waves coming in as AC. Now the diode's job, depending on how they're positioned, if they're positioned positive or negative bias, okay, what their job is to do is to, if they're positioned this way, they let the positive half of the sine wave pass through, and they'll block, and if the negative tries to go through, it blocks the negative. It will not let the negative come through. However, a negative bias diode will let the negative half of the sine wave go through, and it'll block the positive. So what you got is you've got the positive half, the top half of the sine wave going here, and the bottom half going here, positive and negative, and you wind up with DC voltage. So this is called a rectifier, all right? And we are rectifying the alternating current and turning it into DC, all right? And we put this on our, it's called the DC bus. This is our bus right there. And we have a positive and a negative. And this is our known as our DC bus or our DC link. Okay, so, but my point is that these rectifiers here will sort of, for lack of better ways to say it, separate the positive and the negative halves of the sine waves and make basically a DC signal. So we put the AC away and we converted it to DC. Now we've got a DC signal. Now these inductors and these capacitors here, this is a part of a filter that cleans up the signal a little bit. We're not going to worry about that a whole lot. But now we're just dealing with DC. Okay, so we've got our DC coming over here. And then we have these little devices known as insulated gate bipolar transistors, or IGBTs, okay? And these IGBTs are like switches, okay? And these switches are controlled by a little processor, a little small processor in there. And based on what the frequency is we're asking the drive to run the motor at is is the speed at which this controller will control these IGBTs. And what they do, they have a trigger on there, and it will fire the trigger, and a pulse will come out of each one of these, okay? And there's a positive and negative for each phase. This is the positive and the negative IGBT for the first phase, phase A or L1, L2 has the same set in L3. So this controller fires these based on the frequency at which we want the motor to run. And what that looks like is this, okay? So it turns these IGBTs on and off very, very rapidly. This controller does very, very, very rapidly, okay? And when it turns them on and then off, that's all it does. It's on and off. This is on, it's on for, this is the time, this is a timeline right here. So it turns it on and then turns back off. There's a dead space, turns it on, and these are all on the positive side, okay? So the controller is turning them on for X number of milliseconds, and they're very, very short second. And so it turns them on, and then it will turn on the negative side of the negative IGBTs will turn on and give us a negative signal, okay, for a duration of time this long, this long, this long, and this long. And what happens is when what the motor sees is a varying signal going through like this, okay? So if you look, as the motor starts to speed up, I'm gonna step over here for a second. As we first start, the amount of time that the IGB turns on is very short. But as we start to go within just a second or so, we start to increase the amount of time the IGBT keeps that signal going out to the motor, and then it starts to throttle it back to the small amount that we have until there's nothing right there. Then the negative IGB does the exact thing, and what it does is it creates, and this is DC voltage going to an AC motor, by the way, because remember when we turned it from AC to DC, you can't convert it back, okay? So what we've got is we have a simulated AC sine wave coming out of the drive that's going to the motor. Now, one thing about this is this is a DC signal, and one of the first things you'll notice is when you hear a motor that's running off of a VFD as opposed to 60 cycles of AC current, there's a very, very different sound to it, okay? It has a ringing, kind of a pinging sound to it, and I'm going to make a short video showing you what it sounds like and watching it run and things like that. But that's one of the first things you'll hear is that it sounds differently, okay? But it's sending a voltage and then this to the drive from the drive, and then it's varying the current to make it look like or make the motor experience somewhat of an AC sine wave, and it does it for all three phases, okay? Remember, we've got phase one, phase two, phase three, and these IGBTs are firing, and they're going to create three phases of a simulated AC sine wave. So you'll notice that for a short period of distance, it gives us this amount of current. We leave it on a little longer, we get a greater current. We leave it on a little bit longer, a greater current. Now we start to shut it off a little bit sooner, and a little bit sooner until we shut it off completely, okay, and you got no current flow going to the motor. We turn those negative IGBTs on for a period of time. We lengthen that period of time some more, the next firing we lengthen it a little bit more, and then we start to throttle it back down. So like I said, you get a simulated AC sine wave. This is not a true AC sine wave because remember, we converted that from DC, from AC to DC. You can't go back because you need a generation, a source of generation in power, like we've talked about, like the generators from the power plant. We don't have that, and you can't simulate that. So what we got here is a simulated sine wave, but the motor is actually experiencing or seeing DC voltage, okay? And then this is, like I said, this is the voltage here. This is a current wave going there, and this is the amount of time in which they're turning on and off to create this sine wave, okay? Like I said, this current, and there's all three of them going at one time. And yes, they are 120 degrees. I don't show this on this drawing, but if I could move this over here and have it start 120 degrees after this one, and this one 120 degrees after that one, we would have that 120 electrical degrees differentiation, excuse me, between the three phases. So what you're doing is you're creating the ability to control that motor with how long we're leaving these pulses on, okay? What kind of frequency we're sending the motor, okay? Again, this is more of it. Now here's the cool thing about this. If you don't have three-phase voltage going into your drives to run your three-phase motor, no problem. You can do it on single-phase because, let me go back here. If we have two phases going in, okay, this is going to give us half of a positive sine wave, half the negative. It's still creating DC voltage, all right? So that's how we're able to create, to run a three-phase motor on single-phase voltage. So we create that, we run this through our rectifiers still, doing the same thing, except for we just only have two phases going. We run it through our rectifier, and we now have DC. The controller will fire the, remember, all three of these now get the voltage, not just two legs of it, but now that we're coming out with DC, notice it's still connected to all three sets of IGBTs. So they're going to keep firing and still continue to put that simulated sine wave out, and they're going to do it with all three phases. So we have now run a single phase source, power source, and we're now running a three-phase motor with it because we can do that through the drive, okay? So I want to kind of take a quick break here and just let you absorb that real quick. We've got a little bit more to talk about, very little bit to talk about, but we'll talk some more on VFD. So just make sure you come back and watch the next section of this video, okay? Thanks for watching, and we'll see you in just a few minutes.